He's a Plato Cairo. The Sphinx was carved out of solid bedrock over 7,000 years ago, which is the most conservative estimate, according to geologist Robert Schott. This conclusion was reached due to the obvious heavy water erosion. The last time there was heavy rain in the Sahara was at the end of the last ice age. Logic dictates that it was likely constructed well before that worldwide upheaval, so that makes it likely over 12,000 years old. Note those massive, highly eroded carved blocks to the left. That's the Sphinx Temple, constructed with blocks cut out of the bedrock when the Sphinx was carved. Those huge weathered blocks of limestone were cut out of the Sphinx enclosure. They sit atop perfectly carved blocks of rose granite from the quarry at Aswan, 500 miles away, which sit on a foundation of perfectly carved and flattened limestone bedrock. The interior of the Valley Temple is even more impressive with its perfectly flattened, dry-fitted columns of rose granite, again from Aswan, 500 miles away. Despite the consensus among many geologists and so-called alternative researchers, mainstream archaeologists and Egyptologists still cling to the conservative date of around 4,500 years ago for the construction of the Sphinx, or around the same time that the Great Pyramids were supposedly built. Among others, Graham Hancock theorizes that it once had the head of a lion, as the monument would have been pointing directly at the Leo constellation 12,000 years ago. It was probably carved into the likeness of the pharaoh Khafre when he ruled Egypt 4,500 years ago. Others theorize that it was more likely the Khemeshan god Anubis, as it bears more resemblance to a dog than a lion. The Sphinx was buried up to its neck until the late 1800s. Who knows how many times it's been buried, forgotten, and then rediscovered. Luckily, another recent discovery supports the fact that human civilization goes back at least 12,000 years. Göbekli Tepe, Turkey. This is just one of the 20 or more stone circles dated 8 to 10,000 years BC currently being excavated. Each features two giant stone pillars surrounded by a ring of smaller T-shaped pillars. The largest of these stone pillars are up to 6 meters tall, weighing close to 50 tons. Some display complex carvings of animals from other continents, which indicate there were probably already well-established trade networks, or at least regular contact and travel between different regions. Others look like depictions of animals which died out before the last ice age. We're told that when Göbekli Tepe was constructed, humans were nomadic hunter-gatherers, extended family groups moving with the seasons, following herds of animals with crude stone tools and primitive improvised shelter. Mainstream archaeologists still cling to this chronology when attempting to explain Göbekli Tepe. According to them, it was the first temple ever, made by groups of hunter-gatherers. How exactly they suddenly progressed from making reed and mud huts to massive megalithic stone circles seems to have been overlooked. Construction of that scale and sophistication should take centuries of evolution of skills and techniques passed down and refined over many generations. Technological progress does not happen overnight. We're told that the trappings of civilization, such as writing, literature, laws, education, government, cities, banks, money, usury, debt, architecture, metallurgy, etc., appeared suddenly in Mesopotamia, Egypt, India, and China between around 4,000 and 2,000 years BC, pretty much independently. Here we see an ancient Sumerian cuneiform tablet, supposedly the first ever form of written language. Tablets like this one were made by pushing a blunt reed stylus into soft clay, which was then fired. Tablets like this one were created by cylinder seals, the printing press of the era. Here's how they worked. So according to the conventional chronology, technology of that level appeared suddenly and independently in several places. Even more strange, judging by the quality of the stonemasonry, the only artifacts still pretty much intact after thousands of years, technology has regressed steadily. Examples of this are everywhere. Abydos Temple, Egypt. The Osirian. Often, literally, the deeper you dig, the more advanced it gets. This ancient megalithic temple is below water level. This means it was most likely constructed during the last ice age. Its obvious similarities to the Sphinx temple seem to confirm this. Cusco, Peru, the convent of Santo Domingo. This was the heart of the Inca capital, who most likely found this area with its incredible ancient ruins, possibly attributed to their gods, the Viracocha, and decided it was the perfect place to settle. It was known to the Inca as the Coricancha. Fortunately, much of the pre-Inca masonry was beyond the means of the Spanish to destroy, so relics of their amazing stonework still exist. The Spanish reused the stone of the buildings they demolished. It looks like many of the larger granite blocks were beyond their ability to use or even cut. Inca lore states there have been three ages, as depicted in this often used three-step motif: Hanan Pacha, Urun Pacha, and Ukun Pacha. Hanan Pacha, or the First World, is characterized by shapes, steps, rooms, temples, caves, etc., cut right into the bedrock, often with precise angles and perfectly smooth, flat surfaces. The scale of this is sometimes mind-boggling, showing signs of tools and technology we haven't even come close to conceiving of today. These carvings often have no discernible function, as they were sacred to the Inca. Of course, they're now known as religious sites, the default archaeological term to categorize unknown structures, it seems. They often show evidence of major cataclysm, with massive chunks of intricately carved former bedrock scattered around like the building blocks of some humongous toddler. They are often seen carved around natural fissures in the rock. The vast system of tunnels under Cusco, which are said to cover most of South America, were most likely carved in this era. It's evident that at the time of construction, some of the surfaces would have been perfectly flat and polished. Some surfaces even seem to be vitrified, a process in which extreme heat melts the surface, resulting in a glass-like finish. This is impossible to achieve with hand tools and polishing alone. Studies suggest that the effect may have been achieved by a process similar to ceramic glazing of pottery. In our world, that can only be done in a kiln. Could this be the work of the so-called god founders of the pre-Inca world, the Viracocha? It's not as crazy as it sounds, but I'll get into some speculation in the next episode. Now to Urun Pacha, the second world. This is the era of polygonal masonry. It's often seen fitted perfectly around Hanan Pacha stonework, as seen in this picture. Possibly the most spectacular example of Urun Pacha masonry is in Sacsayhuaman, just outside of Cusco, Peru. The blocks, ranging from about 2 to 200 tons, are carved out of limestone and fit together perfectly despite their different shapes and sizes. This may seem haphazard, but it's actually an incredibly advanced construction technique, as in the event of an earthquake, the stones can move without compromising structural integrity. Regularly sized rectangular blocks would not have anywhere near this kind of stability. Archaeologists will tell us that the Inca built this using bronze chisels and stone hammers, all within a few years before the Spanish arrived. This is of course impossible, as it's doubtful such a feat could be accomplished with modern technology, according to the people who would actually know, stonemasons. Of course, this is not taken into consideration, or is just ignored by archaeologists who must adhere to the mainstream chronology. To them, the notion that ancient cultures were more advanced than us is unacceptable, despite the worldwide evidence. This brings us to Ukunpacha, the Third World. This is the time of the Inca, who formed an empire encompassing most of South America west of the Andes by assimilating surrounding tribes. They received the same high standard of living and prosperity as the rest of the empire. Peace usually prevailed, but the conquest made some dangerous enemies. This may have caused the downfall of the Inca when some sided with the Spanish, whom some mistook for the Viracocha, as it was foretold that they'd return that year. It's a deeply sad piece of history. They accomplished some astonishing feats of engineering. This construction is thought to be a terraced farming system designed to create different temperatures and levels of humidity to grow crops of different kinds. It's thought by others to be a giant amphitheater, or maybe a combination of the two. All speculation, of course. Who knows really what its function was? Better than the usual lines from mainstream archaeology, it served a ceremonial or religious purpose, or as a temple complex. Are you starting to see the pattern? At Machu Picchu, we can see three distinct styles of construction in one undeniably incredible location. Note the Inca masonry built on top of the perfectly carved polygonal blocks with scattered remains of the carved bedrock of Hanumpacha. Considering the technology they had at their disposal, the Inca did an incredible job of rebuilding the partially destroyed ancient sites they settled around. The mountain roads, rope bridges, and terracing they built over 500 years ago are still maintained and used today. But compared to whoever created this, the work of the Inca looks primitive. What kind of technology could possibly have scooped close to 1 million cubic meters of siltstone, harder than granite, out of the 36 chambers which have been found so far, with a combined area of around 30,000 square meters? The Longyu Caves in China. Each cave is around 30 meters deep and 140 meters long. The ceilings are supported by pillars shaped from the bedrock. The precision is incredible, with each cave almost identical. The walls between each one are only 50 centimeters thick. Surprisingly, the caves are completely separated. As to what the caves were for, we can only speculate. They display a similar degree of precision, technology, and scale to the ancient pyramids. Both are built over freshwater aquifers. Is it possible they performed a similar function? Of course, archaeologists assure us it was carved painstakingly with crude bronze chisels. Much like this unfinished obelisk at the Aswan quarry that I mentioned before, I'm guessing similar technology was used at both sites. Maybe it was something mechanical similar to what we'd use today in places like this, a potash mine in Utah. These markings bear an uncanny resemblance to what we see at the Longyu Caves and at the Aswan Quarry. This gypsum mine in Ukraine has been worked by a similar but less adorable excavator. The obviously mechanical gouge marks, which are even more prominent in a softer material, are very similar to those found in some of the Longyu caves, which are closed to the public. Let's see what we could use today to lift and move some of the giant stones the ancients built with. These front-end loaders at a marble mine in Greece could move some of the smaller blocks used in the Great Pyramid at about 2 to 4 tons, provided there are roads at the site and machines like these. This lever crane is the largest road-going crane in the world. Although it boasts a capacity of 1,200 tons, there's really no situations in which that would be practical, as it can only handle that weight at a 2.5 meter radius unextended. This chart shows what it can really lift at different heights and radii. Impressive, assuming that you can actually get it to your site. If not, I'm pretty sure our heavy lift helicopters could do the rest, right? Let's have a look. The Russian MIL-MI-12 holds the record for heavy lift choppers at about 40 tons. Unfortunately, it never made it to production. That leaves its little brother, the MI-26, capable of lifting about 20 tons. Surely that's adequate, right? Oliante Tambu, Peru. At over 2,700 meters above sea level on the ridge of a mountain, this is one extreme construction site. Above these ancient fortifications, discovered and repaired to the best of their abilities by the Inca, we find 6 blocks of rose granite carved from a quarry 7 miles across the valley, averaging close to 100 tons each. A crane like this one may be sufficient. With its reach of close to 250 meters and a capacity of 3,500 tons. Sounds impressive, but again, this is only on paper. The capacity drops to 65 tons at maximum height and less as its boom lowers its angle. It might have been handy building something like this. Baalbek, Lebanon. Home of the legendary Trilithon. 3 perfectly carved in place stones weighing around 1,000 tons each, sitting on top of a row of 450 ton blocks, each perfectly carved and fitted. But these are just numbers. How heavy is 1,000 tons in real terms? As heavy as this many original Volkswagen Beetles. Multiplied by 9, haha, that's 1170 small cars. Or 15 full Airbus A320s. Or 4 Statue of Liberties. So that's 1170 cars, 15 jetliners, and 4 massive statues, making up 3 ancient building blocks. And we're taught to consider the builders of this as primitive, because you know what? I'm calling gigantic, golden, galactic bullshit. Evidence all over the world of continuous inhabitation by advanced species, some not even human, and some capable of feats of engineering and stoneworking far superior to humans of today. It's likely some of these are creatures of myth and legend as well as oral history, and some even seem reminiscent of creatures of the Old Testament. Some of the structures in places like Baalbek, Lebanon and parts of Egypt can only possibly have been made by giants for giants. And I'm not talking about little 7-8 foot ones, they had to have been much bigger. Unfortunately, any real evidence seems to have been clouded by hoaxes, especially this infamous Photoshop competition. But fortunately, plenty of evidence does still exist in the form of old newspaper clippings and fragments of bone, which unfortunately are obfuscated as fast as they're discovered. You might have heard of the alleged cover-up of giant skeletons by the Smithsonian. Well, it turns out it's official. They've admitted to the destruction of thousands of giant human skeletons. Some up to 12 feet tall. Sad. And pathetic. At the other end of the scale, we find evidence of dwellings, underground cities, and mines which can only logically have been built by little people, for little people, reminiscent of Tolkien's dwarves.
Evidence for this, such as the Flores Island hobbit, has been written off as recently extinct hominids, predecessors of modern Homo sapiens in the Darwinian model. This totally disregards testimony of earnest natives who apparently have seen them up to recent years. Around the Ural Mountains area of Siberia, when expeditions have been sent out to find new copper deposits, existing mines and traces of their service roads and settlements have been discovered. This was in the late 1700s when these cold, remote areas had no known inhabitants. Four large scientific expeditions were sent out between 1805 and 1890, which established that locals had been in regular contact with these dwarves. They even traded with these dwarves, who were specialists in copper working. Here we can see some of their ornaments. What made them so hard to find is they were accustomed to underground living, so they didn't come out much in the day. Because of that, they had highly sensitive eyes. Speaking of which, here in New Zealand, before the Europeans got here, there were rumours of little people. They were said to be fair-skinned, even glowing, mainly fair and red-haired, with blue eyes which were sensitive to the light. Coincidence? I think not. The Māoris called them the Patupaiarahi. They sound quite reminiscent of the Fae folk in Europe. They were said to be cheeky, mischievous and magical. And like some of the fairies we've heard about, the Patupaiarahi were rumoured to have lured people away with their hypnotic flute tune. It's possible that they, having been hunted to near extinction by the Māori, needed breeding stock, so they lured women away from the village and had their way with them. Apparently they were usually sent home, but from then on they were at the beck and call of the Patupaiarahi, who only had to play their specific flute tune. Dastardly. I haven't been able to find much tangible evidence for these little people except for these coffins, which were found in the Northland area and were quickly covered up. But just yesterday I found this.
The silence by New Zealand authorities on our archaeological past is deafening. None more so than in the Northland Waipua Forest, where in the late 80s, a couple of million dollars was spent of taxpayers' money on an archaeological exploration which discovered evidence of an ancient civilization in a small section of this vast forest. Evidence of temples of worship, irrigation canals, stone houses, hearths and walls has been suppressed by a government order until the year 2063. The big question is, why is this information suppressed? The government must come clean on this, and we as a nation must cooperate to learn more of our past and celebrate these very early mathematicians and surveyors who are the real Tangata Whenua of New Zealand.
There's obviously been Celtic people that have made it to New Zealand in the past, and their culture or their art has been passed down to the Māori, which seems quite obvious to most people, but it's not included in our official history. It looks like some of these early New Zealand inhabitants were bred out of or you know, homogenized into what we call the Māori today. The peaceful tribes probably didn't fare too well. We know some were driven inland into the more inhospitable hill country. And the one tribe which is acknowledged by the mainstream media and were probably Polynesians made their way to the Chatham Islands. But unfortunately, when the Europeans came, the Māori were able to buy muskets. And sometime in the late 1800s, a boatload of armed Māori made their way to the Chatham Islands and wiped pretty much all of them out. The Māori were at war when the Europeans got here, so it's probable that they consisted of a bunch of different tribes from different areas of the Pacific, of the world even. The more warlike ones stayed at war and basically wiped the rest out. The Māori got here from the Pacific Islands in outrigger canoes, but there seems to be a bit of a Norse or Celtic influence on the Māori waka that we see today, who at some point lost their outrigger as they didn't need to leave the country, they didn't need sails or extra stabilisation. They were more built for the coastlines and some of our larger rivers around which they predominantly settled. The Patupaiarahi were said to have built their canoes out of flax reeds, which reminds me of the reed boats that were used in Lake Titicaca as well as in Egypt. The similarities between some of these craft is undeniable, and I don't think anyone in their right mind can deny there was some worldwide seafaring civilization. As can also be seen in the amazing megalithic masonry. So how was that made? They most often built with rocks with a high crystal content, like granite or quartzite, or some types of limestone. Nikola Tesla once said, "In a crystal, we have the clear evidence of the existence of a formative life principle, and though we cannot understand the life of a crystal, it is nonetheless a living being." There's plenty of evidence, well, anecdotal, of the healing power of crystals, written off as pseudoscience by the mainstream, of course. But they seem to forget that quartz crystals have been used for decades in clocks and watches, as they'll indefinitely vibrate at a measurable frequency. And then there's silicon crystals used in microchips, as well as ruby crystals, which are used as a part of a laser to focus and concentrate the energy. In the Book of Stones by Robert Simmons and Naisha Ashyam, it is stated that when we bring the crystal into our electromagnetic field, two things occur. The electromagnetic frequencies carried by the stone will vibrate with related frequencies in our own energy field through the physical law of resonance, creating a third larger vibration field. The nervous system is attuned to these shifts in energy and transmits this information to the brain. Here, the frequencies stimulate biomechanical shifts that affect the body and shift brain function. So I think it's safe to assume that the ancients knew about the power of crystals. To this day, royals wear crystals in their crowns, so coincidence? I'm guessing probably not, whether they know about it these days or not. In recent years, scientists and inventors have been experimenting with acoustic levitation, whereby three or four loudspeakers are pointed to a center point where the object you want to levitate is, and they produce a standing wave. So far, this has only been successful on smaller objects. But I'm guessing, I could be wrong, but I have a feeling that if we were to incorporate crystals, find the resonant frequency of the crystal in rock, for instance, using similar methods, we might have to experiment with different frequencies of sound, maybe go a whole lot higher or lower than has been tried so far. But it's speculated that that could be how some of these massive polygonal structures were built back in the day. Contemporary mad scientist John Hutchison performs similar levitation, but instead of using sound energy, he uses electrical energy by pointing two Tesla coils at the subject. I'm guessing it's a similar principle, using a standing wave of electrical energy, but don't quote me on that one. Now, where it gets really interesting is he actually manages to change the composition of matter. So you can see solid metal objects melting and warping. And so what I'm wondering is, can you do the same thing with stone? Stone with a high quartz content, match up the resonant frequencies, and maybe not only can you levitate stone, but also soften it. There's a lot of evidence on ancient megalithic structures of rock which has been softened and then basically carved or molded like clay. Evidence for this is all over the place. It really looks like the stones were softened in place, kind of squished together, so it looks seamless. Like, seriously, imagine doing this manually with hammers and chisels. The concept is just crazy. Like, to me, that is much crazier than these alternatives I'm exploring here. But if it's still too far-fetched for you, there is even evidence around that granite used to be soft at one point. We all know about the infamous dinosaur footprints with human tracks sort of going in between them, like they were made at exactly the same time, and they probably were. Geologists will tell you this is impossible and it must be fake because, well, it's just not how granite forms, but we have the evidence. Like, look at these so-called cart tracks in Malta. We're looking at hard granite, which obviously was once some sort of soft, muddy, or clay-like material. So, an interesting theory, but in that case, how would the soft megalithic structures have stayed intact this long and subsequently hardened? I think it explains the cart ruts and the tracks, and this giant footprint made famous by Michael Tellinger, but not the polygonal masonry. And speaking of giants, say there were people around that were, you know, 18, 24 feet tall. You wouldn't need levitation to move these giant stones. I mean, maybe the dozen ton ones that we find used at Baalbek. That could be a bit of a stretch, but, you know, these 2 to 60, 100 ton ones even, that'd be pretty easy for a bunch of giants of that stature. But I'm guessing they used both methods. If the giants didn't have this levitation technology or the stone softening technology, maybe they did have some pretty amazing power tools. Sounds crazy, but check this out. This is obviously what we would know as modern tool marks, you know, like a circular saw blade. Like, it's unmistakable. This is Turkey, but, you know, we see similar evidence in parts of Egypt. So maybe they were electrical. We all know about the Giza power plant theory, and we've all probably seen these giant light bulbs which were probably used to light the pyramids, as there's no trace of soot buildup. they had to be lighting it somehow. And I'm thinking that the standard explanation by the quackademics, in which a series of golden mirrors were used to reflect lights deep down the passages, is a complete bunch of crap. So they probably did have electric lighting. And then why not electric tools? The amazing thing is that these tools were technologically far superior to anything that we use these days. And they did a better job too. Some of these flat surfaces are to a tolerance that we wouldn't even bother with these days, like these so-called giant sarcophagi. They're insane. The top and bottom made out of single pieces of stone, polished to something like 1/2000th of an inch tolerance. We don't even know how they got them in there, let alone made them in the first place. And there's evidence of use of circular saw type plates, which were much finer and much larger than ones that we can produce today, and capable of withstanding a much greater force. So they obviously had the technology. Oh, and we're not even getting into the ancients' use of geopolymers, the most obvious of which is even documented, the Roman concrete, which is still holding up over millennia, well, you know, according to the standard chronology. In the not-so-ancient Khmer Kingdom of Cambodia and Myanmar, we see what looks like polygonal blocks made out of softened stone geopolymer, which is built around standard bricks. So obviously there was some sort of transitional period between the polygonal masonry, possibly made out of softened stone and or geopolymer. I showed a similar but even more baffling amalgamation of technology in part 2 in Cappadocia, Turkey. Here we see what looks to be a geopolymer plaster type facade, and at the bottom you can see what looks to be stones or bricks and mortar with the geopolymer facade over it, and it's also kind of stuck onto the bedrock. It looks to be a similar sort of technology used in Petra, Jordan. We're told this is all cut out of bedrock, but is it? You can see it's a slightly lighter colour than the bedrock and a lot more consistent, and well, it's just impossible to carve with that sort of precision. It looks to be moulded, and the way it's sort of stuck onto the rock face is incredible. You can see in places it's almost peeling off, and take a look at the scale of this place. It's just insane, and some bits look to be maybe thousands of years older than others, with some serious erosion. You can see, like in Cappadocia, you've got rooms that are just open to the elements because it looks like the whole rock face has just crumbled away. And some of it's got that soft organic look to it from what looks to be water erosion or sand erosion, possibly. According to the official narrative, Petra was founded by Nabataeans, who were nomads, and it was only inhabited between about 300 BC and 300 AD. But just a quick glance at these photos completely destroys that narrative. Obviously, like the underground cities of Cappadocia, this goes back much further, and most likely it's been inhabited by a lot of different people. So there's definite similarities to the underground city of Derinkuyu, which I showed at the start of the video, but what might surprise you is that there's similar underground cities or networks of tunnels in Bulgaria, Iran, India, Italy, Spain, China, Switzerland, Georgia, Syria, Romania, Afghanistan. I could go on.
Cappadocia, Turkey, an area most widely known for its breathtaking volcanic topography, particularly the fairy chimneys, the result of countless millennia of volcanic eruptions and erosion.
Over time, the volcanic ash compresses into a stone called tufa. The lower layer we see here, at its hardest, it's about as hard as limestone, around 4 on the Mohs scale, diamond being 10. The upper layer is called ignimbrite, which is basically cooled compressed lava. It's almost as hard as granite at about 6 to 7 on the Mohs scale. Natural faults in the underlying bedrock or the tougher stone itself have caused parts to fall away, allowing weather erosion to gradually shape the landscape we see today. Cappadocia is also famous for the carved rooms, tunnels, towns, and even cities which honeycomb the area. Nobody knows who originally carved them, but the area was primarily inhabited by the Hittites from the 18th to the 12th century BC, the Persians from the 6th to the 4th century BC, and the Romans, along as on and off by the Assyrians, and the Coptic Christians who hid out in these caves from the Holy Roman Empire. So determining who originally carved them out and who made the subsequent renovations is damn near impossible. For instance, are these renovations Hittite, Christian, Roman, Persian? Other than all these arches, which history tells us must be Byzantine era, this architecture looks Hittite to me, but how would you know? And look at the various states of disrepair of all these dwellings. The area is literally honeycombed, and judging by the state of some of it, it looks like the more modern civilizations that we know of have built on the ruins of an even more ancient civilization. Keep this in mind as we'll be coming back to this concept. Here we can see some possible Roman renovations, Byzantine era maybe, in various states of disrepair. Again, probably built on much more ancient cave dwellings. Just look at the state of that cliff face. How long does this stone take to erode? I'm guessing this is the exposed tufa or tufa stone here. Seriously, geologists out here, I would like to know. It was common practice to make bricks out of the tufa stone, which makes a great building material, as you can see. But look at these highly eroded ancient dwellings carved out of the same material. We think of ancient cultures as pretty backward, but I don't think anybody in history would be stupid enough to build rooms exposed to the cliff face, so this indicates the erosion took place a long time after these dwellings were built, and a long time before any of these newer surface additions, some of which we're told date back over 2,000 years. The Servian Wall in Rome, dating to around the 4th century BC, was built with bricks carved from the same type of rock. It was abandoned in the early 1st millennium, which gives us an idea of how much erosion we can expect to see over a period of around 2,000 years, in a much wetter climate than central Turkey. Speaking of wet, time to go underground. This is a tourist map of a small part of the famous city of Derinkuyu, one of the 40 or so documented underground cities in this area. Feel free to pause this for a few facts about Derinkuyu. What you need to know is this was a fully functioning underground city, capable of housing around 50,000 people, maybe more. If you decide to visit Derinkuyu, you can only visit around 10%, and people that have been there say that even that is mind-boggling. The inhabitants had everything they needed to live down there. The city seems to have been fairly sophisticated. There are shafts to keep fresh air flowing and giant stone doors which were basically rolled into place, which kept potential invaders out. So check out this shot of the inside of Derinkuyu. That is some heavy water erosion, which indicates there must have been water flowing through here at one point. A lot of water.
Note that the chisel marks are only visible halfway up the walls, and those smooth organic shapes in the lower part of the wall, definitely water erosion. Judging by the amount of erosion we see here, the ancient carved towns of Cappadocia must be orders of magnitude older than that 2100-year Roman wall. Whoever carved some of these rooms back in the day paid extraordinary attention to detail. Carving flat surfaces into rock with right angles on inward surfaces is not easy, even in relatively soft rock. Or did they actually use plaster still holding up over the millennia? Here we can see some exposed stone masonry with mortar, which looks like it's been plastered over. Some of these areas look like a bomb was dropped. What happened here? Shit's all topsy-turvy up in here, y'all. This looks like the result of a major cataclysm. What kind of force can break solid pieces of granite from the bedrock, hurling them into a position like this, upside down? All of these ruins are attributed to the Inca around 500 years ago. Geologists and stonemasons will tell you this is utterly absurd, but unfortunately, archaeologists must adhere to the chronology that we've been presented with. It seems much more likely that the Inca merely found these ancient ruins, who believed them to be the work of the gods, and repaired them to the best of their ability, which can be seen clearly in the bottom right of this throne-looking thing. Which is much more likely a piece of some other building or construction which has kind of fallen here by the look of it. Note the smaller blocks used on the bottom level. Not bad, right? The Inca did a damn good job of considering the level of technology they had compared to that of the original builders of the fortress of Ollantaytambo. That stonework at the top is just amazing. See those giant, perfectly carved megalithic blocks scattered around the place like they're the building blocks of some giant? That would take some major force. Now, back to Cappadocia. Just kidding, we're still in South America, Bolivia this time. The stone is rose granite, which is much harder than the tougher stone of the Turkey underground cities. Judging by the amount of erosion on each, is it possible these are about the same age? Peru has numerous examples of ancient architecture and building techniques similar to those used in Cappadocia. There's also a vast network of underground tunnels carved out of the bedrock surrounding Cusco, Peru. They're so large that many explorers have gone in and not come out, which has caused them to be closed by the Peru government, blocked off. Local legend says the network of tunnels covers most of South America.
Cuneiform tablet, supposedly the first ever form of written language. Tablets like this one were made by pushing a blunt reed stylus into soft clay, which was then fired. And tablets like this one were created by cylinder seals, the printing press of the era. Here's how they worked. According to the conventional chronology, technology of that level appeared suddenly and independently in several places. Even more strange, judging by the quality of the stonemasonry, the only artifacts still pretty much intact after thousands of years, technology has regressed steadily. Examples of this are everywhere. Abydos Temple, Egypt. The Osirian. Often, literally, the deeper you dig, the more advanced it gets. This ancient megalithic temple is below water level. This means it was most likely constructed during the last ice age. Its obvious similarities to the Sphinx temple seem to confirm this. Cusco, Peru, the convent of Santo Domingo. This was the heart of the Inca capital, who most likely found this area with its incredible ancient ruins, possibly attributed to their gods, the Viracocha, and decided it was the perfect place to settle. It was known to the Inca as the Coricancha. Fortunately, much of the pre-Inca masonry was beyond the means of the Spanish to destroy, so relics of their amazing stonework still exist. The Spanish reused the stone of the buildings they demolished. It looks like many of the larger granite blocks were beyond their ability to use or even cut. Inca lore states there have been three ages, as depicted in this often used three-step motif: Hanampacha, Urunpacha, and Ukunpacha. Hanampacha, or the First World, is characterized by shapes, steps, rooms, temples, caves, etc., cut right into the bedrock, often with precise angles and perfectly smooth, flat surfaces. The scale of this is sometimes mind-boggling, showing signs of tools and technology we haven't even come close to conceiving of today. These carvings often have no discernible function, as they were sacred to the Inca. Of course, they're now known as religious sites, the default archaeological term to categorize unknown structures, it seems. They often show evidence of major cataclysm, with massive chunks of intricately carved former bedrocks scattered around like the building blocks of some humongous toddler. They are often seen carved around natural fissures in the rock. The vast system of tunnels under Cusco, which are said to cover most of South America, were most likely carved in this era. It's evident that at the time of construction, some of the surfaces would have been perfectly flat and polished. Some surfaces even seem to be vitrified, a process in which extreme heat melts the surface, resulting in a glass-like finish. This is impossible to achieve with hand tools and polishing alone. Studies suggest that the effect may have been achieved by a process similar to ceramic glazing and then rediscovered. Luckily, another recent discovery supports the fact that human civilization goes back at least 12,000 years. Göbekli Tepe, Turkey. This is just one of the 20 or more stone circles dated 8 to 10,000 years BC currently being excavated. Each features two giant stone pillars surrounded by a ring of smaller T-shaped pillars. The largest of these stone pillars are up to 6 meters tall, weighing close to 50 tons. Some display complex carvings of animals from other continents, which indicate there were probably already well-established trade networks, or at least regular contact and travel between different regions. Others look like depictions of animals which died out before the last ice age. We're told that when Göbekli Tepe was constructed, humans were nomadic hunter-gatherers.
extended family groups moving with the seasons, following herds of animals with crude stone tools and primitive improvised shelter. Mainstream archaeologists still cling to this chronology when attempting to explain Göbekli Tepe. According to them, it was the first temple ever, made by groups of hunter-gatherers. How exactly they suddenly progressed from making reed and mud huts to massive megalithic stone circles seems to have been overlooked. Construction of that scale and sophistication should take centuries of evolution of skills and techniques passed down and refined over many generations. Technological progress does not happen overnight. We're told that the trappings of civilization, such as writing, literature, laws, education, government, cities, banks, money, usury, debt, architecture, metallurgy, etc., appeared suddenly in Mesopotamia, Egypt, India, and China between around 4000 and 2000 years BC, pretty much independently. Here we see an ape pottery. In our world, that can only be done in a kiln. Could this be the work of the so-called god founders of the pre-Inca world, the Viracocha? It's not as crazy as it sounds, but I'll get into some speculation in the next episode. Now to Urumpacha, the second world. This is the era of polygonal masonry. It's often seen fitted perfectly around Hunanpacha stonework, as seen in this picture. Possibly the most spectacular example of Urumpacha masonry is in Sacsayhuaman, just outside of Cusco, Peru. The blocks, ranging from about 2 to 200 tons, are carved out of limestone and fit together perfectly despite their different shapes and sizes. This may seem haphazard, but it's actually an incredibly advanced construction technique, as in the event of an earthquake, the stones can move without compromising structural integrity. Regularly sized rectangular blocks would not have anywhere near this kind of stability. Archaeologists will tell us that the Inca built this using bronze chisels and stone hammers, all within a few years before the Spanish arrived. This is of course impossible, as it's doubtful such a feat could be accomplished with modern technology, according to the people who would actually know, stonemasons. Of course, this is not taken into consideration or is just ignored by archaeologists who must adhere to the mainstream chronology. To them, the notion that ancient cultures were more advanced than us is unacceptable, despite the worldwide evidence. This brings us to Urumpacha, the third world. This is the time of the Inca, who formed an empire encompassing most of South America west of the Andes by assimilating surrounding tribes. They received the same high standard of living and prosperity as the rest of the empire. Peace usually prevailed, but the conquest made some dangerous enemies. This may have caused the downfall of the Inca when some sided with the Spanish, whom some mistook for the Viracocha, as it was foretold that they'd return that year. It's a deeply sad piece of history. Giza Plateau, Cairo. The Sphinx was carved out of solid bedrock over 7,000 years ago, which is the most conservative estimate, according to geologist Robert Schott. This conclusion was reached due to the obvious heavy water erosion. The last time there was heavy rain in the Sahara was at the end of the last ice age. Logic dictates that it was likely constructed well before that worldwide upheaval, so that makes it likely over 12,000 years old. Note those massive, highly eroded carved blocks to the left. That's the Sphinx Temple, constructed with blocks cut out of the bedrock when the Sphinx was carved. Those huge, weathered blocks of limestone were cut out of the Sphinx enclosure. They sit atop perfectly carved blocks of rose granite from the quarry at Aswan, 500 miles away, which sit on a foundation of perfectly carved and flattened limestone bedrock. The interior of the Valley Temple is even more impressive with its perfectly flattened, dry-fitted columns of rose granite, again from Aswan, 500 miles away.
Despite the consensus among many geologists and so-called alternative researchers, mainstream archaeologists and Egyptologists still cling to the conservative date of around 4,500 years ago for the construction of the Sphinx, or around the same time that the Great Pyramids were supposedly built. Among others, Graham Hancock theorizes that it once had the head of a lion, as the monument would have been pointing directly at the Leo constellation 12,000 years ago. It was probably carved into the likeness of the pharaoh Khafre when he ruled Egypt 4,500 years ago. Others theorize that it was more likely the Khemeshan god Anubis, as it bears more resemblance to a dog than a lion. The Sphinx was buried up to its neck until the late 1800s. Who knows how many times it's been buried, forgotten, and